We think of the concept of childhood with some nostalgia. It is that brief, idyllic time of life when children should be busy at school and play, loved and cared for in community, safe from violence, and protected from abuse and exploitation. However, this understanding of childhood is both culturally and historically located. In ancient Greece and Rome, infanticide was not uncommon. The male head of the household could legally decide at birth if an infant would live or be abandoned to death. Deformation, illegitimacy, and being female were all common reasons for newborn infants to be left outside the city walls to die of exposure. In the Greco-Roman world, children had no legal rights. If infants were deemed worthy of survival in both the Greek and the Roman context, then males from status homes received an education and went through various rituals to mark their approach toward adulthood. In the Middle Ages, like ancient Greece and Rome, some historians estimate as much as a third of all infants born were victims of infanticide. But unlike the Greco-Roman world, in which childhood was at least a recognized social period in a person's life, there was little concept of childhood in the medieval era. Children were generally considered to be mini-adults who inhabited the adult worlds of work, social life, and sex. The early church father, Augustine, argued that it was better for a child to suffer physical blows on earth than to burn in hell. Children didn't really have a human status in the Middle Ages. In fact, there was debate about whether or not they had a soul. In the Industrial Age, child labor was prolific in the mills, factories, and mines in Britain and North America. 14-hour days with only brief breaks, little food or sleep, working in dangerous conditions, often maimed, sometimes killed. Dead babies could be found on the streets of London, abandoned. As the Industrial Revolution reached maturity, there were many great reformers who fought for the rights of the child, and great gains were made by them, both legally and socially. And so the 20th century is now referred to as the century of the child, because many nations committed to the ideology that governments are obliged to protect children and their interests, committed to that. To different degrees and in different places, child labor was outlawed. Sale and marketing to children of adult vices was outlawed, tobacco, alcohol, pornography. Consumer protection laws were designed to pay special attention to product safety and to advertising aimed at children. Governments provided children with education and health care, and parents and caregivers were made criminally liable for neglecting or exploiting children. Most modern nations embraced those reforms, which were entrenched in international law and the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of the Child in 1959. History, as I have outlined it also very briefly, characterizes the nature and experience of childhood very differently in various eras. So how will the future characterize our era as it relates to children? I offer us a series of snapshots. Sexualized childhood. Collectively, studies consistently indicate that about 75% of teens report getting most of their information about sex as children, mostly from the media, some from their friends. In an informal poll that I take annually in the marriage and family class that I teach, about 75% of our own students report the same. Nickelodeon, one of the leading television programmers for children, receives many awards for its educational children's programming, while at the same time offering increasingly sexualized content to increasingly younger children. They feature on-air concerts and Kids' Choice Awards with pop stars such as Miley Cyrus, Britney Spears, Jennifer Lopez, Jessica Simpson, Spice Girls, Christina Aguilera. These shows target preschoolers and preteens, what are now called tweens in the research. And these pop star icons wear very sexualized clothing, they dance provocatively, and many of their lyrics are sexually suggestive. They are very adult. Yet the research indicates that tweens report wanting to emulate these pop stars. 10 to 14-year-olds account for 9% of the CD sales of these highly sexualized pop icons. They are held up for our young daughters to emulate and our sons to see as desirable females. As Professor Rustakeem Balaji pointed out recently, viewing such music videos resulted in my daughter shaking a booty she shouldn't know she has. Children's toys and clothing encourage younger and younger girls to present themselves sexually. You can purchase jailbait t-shirts for girls as young as 7, padded bras and bikinis for girls, thongs marketed to 10-year-olds that include wink wink and eye candy on the front, tramp stamps available at Toys R Us, sexualized Halloween costumes, and even a peekaboo stripper pole, sold online by British toy company Tesco. These types of products are described by child marketing departments as age-appropriate with an edge. The most popular doll ever to hit the market is Barbie, which sells in the millions. Clearly intended to be sexy when first released, Barbie has nevertheless become increasingly sexualized. You can now even purchase for your 3 or 4-year-old a lingerie Barbie. In a real woman, Barbie's measurements would be 36, 15, 33, which would require the removal of a bone and insufficient fat for menstruation and pregnancy. Barbie, however, now faces its first serious competition in the Bratz dolls that are currently outselling Barbie. With their highly sexualized lips and eyes, poses, and clothing, you can actually purchase real-life Bratz clothing, including bikini underpants for preschool girls. And in my estimation, the ultimate obscenity in children's dolls, the Bratz babies, Roxy and Phoebe, affectionately nicknamed the Bratz hooker babies. Dora, Rainbow Bright, Strawberry Shortcake, the Powerpuff Girls, My Little Pony, etc., have all undergone sexual transformations. Yes, even a pony can be sexualized. Violent childhood. Violent first-person shooter video games have been the cause of growing concern for quite some time. Research on video game violence has produced one of the strongest research platforms in psychology, indicating evidence of increased aggression resulting from excessive violent video gaming. While rated for older teens and adults, we know that these games are in the hands of much younger consumers, primarily male, through older siblings, cousins, friends, and often through purchase. According to a 2009 national study conducted by leading researcher Douglas Gentile, nearly one half of all 12 to 16-year-olds and a quarter of 8 to 11-year-olds own mature-rated games. Game design guru John Hobson talks about industry practices of hiring behavioral psychologists to assist in creating the game designs to find more powerful ways to make players play forever. They are intentionally addictive and they're very successful. Aggression and violence is also an integral part of toys and shows for boys. G.I. Joe, Transformers, Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, Batman, Spider-Man, Superman, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, etc., have also all undergone makeovers. They now look much more powerful, threatening, and violent. They teach increasingly young boys that masculinity and aggression go hand in hand, and these heroes are held up for our young sons to emulate and our daughters to admire as impressive males. The children's online video game market has exploded in the last 10 years. AddictingGames.com, which is one of the web's premier casual games sites, has 10 million players each month, the majority of which are children and teens. Here's a sample of the types of games that children are playing. Stairfall. Pushing someone down the stairs has never been so awesome. The more damage they take, the more points you get. How bloody can you make this paper creation? Fuzzy McFluffenstein 2. The pet store couldn't get any more bloody. See how many cute furry things you can turn into messy red pools. Kill a Kitty 2. This kitty needs to die. All it takes is one click of your choice and then watch as hilarity ensues. Will it be the killer bee or the killer heel? Remember, these are little children that are playing these games. While framed as animation for kids, these games nevertheless deal in themes of blood, gore, and death. Porn. Julia Beasley did a superb job of covering this topic, so I simply want to remind you that what she said is very relevant to this conversation as well. Given the increasingly young ages of porn users and that the most frequently downloaded form of porn is gonzo porn, which is the rape porn, porn has clearly become sex education for increasingly younger children. Exploited children. Kid marketing, as it's usually called, is an industry that barely existed just a half century ago. Currently, $15 billion is spent on children's advertising annually. Clothes, snacks, toys, activities, lessons, experiences, you name it. According to a North American advertising expert, children are the brightest star in the consumer constellation. We increasingly see kids through an economic lens. They hire psychologists to train their staff regarding child development, and they hire market researchers to collect information about kids. The idea is to get information they need so they can target their campaigns to hook children by exploiting their developmental vulnerabilities. We know from psychological research that the need for significance and the need for belonging are fundamental requirements for healthy child development. For kid marketers, the need for significance translates into there is no end to teen narcissism. Playing off teen securities is a proven strategy. For kid marketers, the need to belong translates into to win these children's business, retailers should change their goal to selling a community experience instead of selling a product. The need for significance and belonging, basic human needs, have been turned into a site of marketing exploitation of children. We live in a time when manipulating children's deep emotions is now a formula for success. Kids marketers push that formula as far as they can, doing whatever it takes without apparent constraint or concern to work the emotions of youth into profit. It's just a standard business practice. Rates. According to the HBSC study conducted jointly by the World Health Organization and the Public Health Agency of the Government of Canada, a minimum of 50% of Canadian youth aged 11 to 15 have a total daily screen time of 6 or more hours. This study doesn't examine the number of hours of the other 50%, but from smaller studies, we know that most of them spend close to a minimum of 4 hours per day of screen time. In a 2003 study, 0 to 6, Media and the Lives of Infants and Toddlers, yes, infants and toddlers, 36% of children under 6 live in households where the TV is always on, 36% of 0 to 3-year-olds and 43% of 4 to 6-year-olds have a TV set in their bedrooms. Regulation. In Canada, these are the organizations that govern all media commerce. In every one of these organizations tasked with regulating standards in the media industry, among them protecting children, compliance to their standards is voluntary. Yeah, voluntary. In other words, the makers of violent video games, the producers of violent, sexualized, addicting online games, the purveyors of kid marketing, and the sexually inundated music industry are in charge of regulating themselves. There are no real penalties for transgression. It is all done in good faith. Given the astronomical profits of various child industries that we've just discussed, clearly the competition for financial gain is intense. To expect self-regulation to successfully protect children in such a context is equivalent to asking a team of NHL hockey players competing for the Stanley Cup or a team of NFL football players competing for the Super Bowl to call and enforce their own penalties throughout the game and actually throughout the season. It's absurd. In fact, it's just plain laughable. What kind of a world have we become when leading purveyors of children's entertainment, kids' marketing corporations, and producers of children's toys can offer this type of toxic content to our children? It's actually not laughable. It's tragic. And despite all the work done in the second half of the 20th century on the rights of the child to protect childhood as a precious time in which children should live free from fear, safe from violence, and protected from abuse and exploitation, it seems that on our watch, the ball has indeed been dropped. I will leave us to ponder the words of the great reformer Nelson Mandela. There can be no keener revelation of a society's soul than the way in which it treats its children. Thank you.